Now, all of you would be doing research in your studies, and the word research is derived from Middle French, researcher, which means to go about seeking. And you may be forgiven for assuming that research is only undertaken at universities and that it is the role of the academic to lead this. However, research is fundamental to the practice of architecture. Research comprises creative work undertaken on a systematic basis in order to increase the stock of knowledge, including knowledge of man, culture, and society, and use of this stock of knowledge to devise new applications. And most architects not only research the place and people and the culture in for which they are designing, but they also visit other cultures to develop their understanding of buildings of these cultures. Similarly, cities are also studied for their values as models and sources of inspirations or benchmarks against which one can judge one's ideas. Our cities undergo constant development, but the challenge ahead is one of a world often abused by unsustainable development. One of the key ways to be sustainable is to promote high-density development while providing quality public spaces and an enhanced urban realm, making cities desirable. Sydney, as well as other major cities, face the challenge of future expansion, and how this challenge is addressed is of interest to all of us. Today's speaker, Bob Perry, is Director of Multidisciplinary Practice. Scott Carver is Sydney-based practice of 50 architects, with urban designers, landscape and interior design architects. Bob is also a board member of Place Leaders Asia Pacific. Scott Carver's works include high-density mixed-use communities, retail and hospitality projects, as well as special projects like Netball Central, the first sports facility to be built at Sydney Olympic Park since the Sydney 2000 Games, and various projects currently under construction at the Sydney Opera House. Bob is an enthusiast for high-density urban living and is a frequent traveler to Tokyo, where he claims we can see the future of first-world cities now. His lecture today will focus on the practice's current projects in Sydney's Homebush Bay region and will refer to his research in Japan and China under his own theory of agrodynamics. Please all welcome Bob Perry.
Thank you, Nina, and thank you, everybody, for coming along. I have 50 minutes to show you 500 images at 6 seconds each, including videos. So sit back and relax. I'm sure you watch a lot of media, and I'm sure you're up for it. First of all, a lot of what I'm going to talk about today, or one particularly focused project I did, was to write an e-book for Place Leaders Asia Pacific. If you go to this website, in the 2013 e-book, you'll see an article I wrote, which I spent a lot of time on, which is called Tokyo versus Urban Sprawl, Our Eyes Create the City. I think you'll find that interesting. Today I wanted to talk to you about a word I coined as a mental map for thinking about cities, which is agrodynamics. I travel a lot to Japan because I discovered many years ago that it's the kind of city I would love to live in. I don't think we have real cities in Australia. We have automobile cities. Tokyo has 35 million people, 28 million of whom live in the same physical size footprint as Sydney. And it's a surprising place. It's a very social place. The streets are quieter, cleaner and safer than streets in Sydney. And people are very polite and children walk around the city. All sorts of things that we imagine might be good in our cities occur in this extreme density. So if you go to Tokyo, you realise that in Australia we are density snobs. And a lot of discussion about density centres around third world cities. Tokyo you can't ignore because it's extremely first world. So today I wanted to talk a bit about that. I understand, John, you asked some students to look at this video. Who's seen this? Some? I won't play all of it, but this is 5 minutes at Kishijoji. It's a typical corner in a shopping area in Tokyo and represents, I think, many of the things that are different about our cities, such as shared pathways. You see how cars, pedestrians and cycles interact. if you were to script all these actors to do this on a corner, it would be possible. See the mother coming around here with two kids on the bike. So nice thing about video when you travel, I think, is if you just stop for 5 minutes, later on when you look at it, you see all sorts of extraordinary things happening that you didn't see at the time. This video is actually on Scott Carver's website. It's not really meant to be entertainment, but it's extremely informative in terms of social behaviour in cities. You can see deliveries, all the systems of the city, school kids wandering around. The most important thing here, I think, is the efficiency of the use of space. The width of that street would be typically like one of our footpaths. So we've built cities with these huge, overly specific, dedicated carriageways. Indeed, the fight over cycleways is a typical debate. Cyclists want their own lane. There are millions of cyclists in Tokyo, and I've never seen one dedicated cyclist lane. Notice the far mirror on that truck. See how it moves in automatically when he parks? That saves 300 millimetres in the street. To me, that's urban design. Then you watch this 70-year-old man here who's peaceful at the moment. Then something happens. See how dexterous he is? Why is he worried? So the most disarming thing about Tokyo is that this is about as loud as it gets. The loudest noise in Tokyo is the sound of people talking and walking around. It's the ultimate pedestrianised city. So because of time constraints, I'll move on. But this is the sort of nutty stuff I do. And I've found that video, as opposed to photography, shot from waist height so people don't think you're actually shooting it, is a really great way to record social behaviour in cities. And I think in the end, social behaviour is the most interesting thing about cities. So to my term, agrodynamics. Who of you knows of the word agora? Do you know what an agora is? Not particularly. The agora was the Greek open space where markets were founded, or where democracy is purported to have begun. It was a large public space in the middle of Greek cities. The ruins of the agora in Athens are still there at the base of the Parthenon. And this one in Corinth also exists in ruins. The thing that we forget about the agora is that it was actually the marketplace. It was the shopping centre of the Greek city, bearing in mind that Athens had a population of about 120,000 people at this time. And it was a necessary function socially because there was no way of recording contracts, for example. Contracts were verbal between people with witnesses. So the agora was the place where people went to interact with in any particular way. And I imagine the agora not so much for its Doric columns and its classical architectural order, but I think of it more like this market in Beijing. It would have been probably an amazing fresh food environment. And the stores along the edges were full of granaries and perishable foods, not dissimilar to a supermarket in many ways. So my term agrodynamics is a way of thinking about cities similar to aerodynamics, which is a 20th century discipline, whereas aerodynamics is interested in reducing drag coefficients to make things go faster. Agrodynamics is interested in maximising drag so that we get traction in cities and engagement. And I find that there isn't really a way of talking about cities. There isn't useful enough terms where we can be critical. The only other root word in the English language from agora is agoraphobia. You've probably heard of agoraphobics. They are people who don't like going out, or a fear of people. It's actually a fear of social engagement. So if that word exists, we should obviously have the word agoraphilia, which would be a normal love of open spaces and public spaces. People who go shopping would be agoraphiliacs, I think. So agrodynamics, my definition, would be the study of the interaction between the city and people moving through its public realm. So we could then have adjectives. Agrodynamic, we could describe space as being agrodynamic. We could be agrodynamicists. I would describe myself as an agrodynamicist now, ahead of being an architect, I think. And therefore, we could have the negative. Anagoric. We could talk about places that are not agrodynamic or are anagoric. Most Australian cities, and most of them I think, are anagoric places. They fail to be places. This is an anagoric place. Although a lot of people aspire to live this way, it's an extremely antisocial way to live. Every person has a swimming pool. They have a kitchen large enough to cater for a village of people. Not that they have any friends, but they've got a kitchen in case they have some one day. The houses turn their backs on the street. There's usually cars parked along the street. So this is the idea of owning your own whole town so that you don't have to interact with anybody. Waterfront properties are even worse. The pretense that you actually own the view. And in doing all of this, we're actually turning our backs on each other. And this is a typically Australian malaise. And public space that is created is anagoric in the extreme. Our movement patterns lead us to isolated lives too. We drive around amongst each other more than we interact with each other. There are more cars imported to Sydney every year than people. Okay, they don't live as long. That would make sense statistically. But the number of cars imported through Sydney every year is ridiculous, hundreds of thousands. And so the environments that come from this, the information environments that respond to movement through cars, are crass and obvious and reasonably witless. And the kinds of environments that communicate with cars mean that signage and graphics dominate buildings and kind of take over the public realm. Footpaths are rarely used, and the exteriors of buildings don't really mean very much. This is a footpath at Parramatta Road, which actually has moss growing on it. I doubt that it's actually ever used. So an interesting reference here too is Peter Newman's diagram. You might have seen this before, which measures gasoline consumption per capita across urban density in persons per hectare. So up the top here are the American cities with Houston at the top. Sydney is in that grouping of automobile-based cities. In the middle we have European and some Asian cities, which makes sense. And over here on the extreme we have Asian cities, which are Hong Kong being, if you like, from a transport energy consumption point of view, the most efficient city in the world. So for those of us who are snobs about density, this is a worrying diagram. So Sydney and Tokyo are almost polar opposites on the diagram. We're the guzzlers and people in Tokyo are the greens. So I think that follows largely that our cities are anagoric environments. The Japanese and Asian environments are more agrodynamic. And Beijing, which sits in there in the Asian cities too, is tracking as fast as it can towards the past, back into the 20th century by replicating all the mistakes we made. So I now wanted to move on to a project, and this will inform you a little bit as to why I'm concerned with these matters. 10 years ago, I did a master plan for this site. This is at Homebush Bay. The Sydney Olympics site is in the background there. And it's an 11-hectare site that a client of mine bought. And we did a master plan for it to put 5- and 8-storey apartments. And we drew a footbridge across the bay. This has developed over the years. And this is one of the control diagrams I did at the time, which was to imprint the idea of diversity. So each of those colour codings represents a place, rather than assuming a different architect should do each donut of buildings in the interest of diversity. We said we really should be designing different plays around a given block so that the street between in the end is the purpose of the design moves. We also did a reasonably radical thing because there's a water table 500 millimetres below ground level and you can't put cars underground. The vexed problem of car parking haunted us. So we got permission to build a architectonic topography which raises 2 stories high above natural ground. And underneath that, we could put most of the cars coming up to street level. So that was the master plan at the time. We put all sorts of optical controls into it. And then the bridge became a fascination. And so simultaneously with this, we went to the government. Our client had this idea that if the 4 remaining landowners on Wentworth Point, as this is now called, got together, we would be happy to build a bridge to roads to connect to the railway station if they gave us uplift in apartment numbers. That transaction's finished. These were some of the studies we did for studies of height on the site. And the bridge was subsequently approved and we let a contract for its construction a few weeks ago. So the bridge is now being built ahead of most of the development. And curiously, it'll be the first bridge in Sydney on which cars won't be allowed to travel. It's exclusively for buses, cyclists and pedestrians and connects up the 2 high-density neighbourhoods of Wentworth Point and Rhodes. These were some of the early studies we did on the issue of parking again, which is a particularly Australian curse. So we're building these cities to European densities, but we have to stuff cars in them because people won't buy them unless you do. And this is a project which is innovating around that stupid problem. So you can see from these studies how we have to sleeve apartments. And as soon as we put towers on the site, of course, the car parking starts creeping up above street level, as it would have had we not put the artificial topography in. So we know our way around that building type, and now, as a progress report, particular buildings have been designed, 350 apartments per block. This stage was completed, the scaffolding came off a couple of weeks ago, and we're now designing towers and further uplifts. So this is our first street, Scott Carter's first street, which is called Footbridge Boulevard, which we put on a plan many years ago and made its way into street directories. And it has 2 8-storey buildings either side. It's waiting for the plane trees down the middle. It's in its raw construction state. But you can see here in the second stage how we tried to make the block look like they were separate buildings, even though there are commodity home units in behind it. We think that was reasonably successful. This is a view looking from the fully developed Wentworth Point. To the left is one of the government's new urban activation precincts, which brings even further density. And there's the bridge going across to Rhodes Peninsula. This is a view towards Rhodes from the park on our site. And that's the final bridge design. And this is a view from the bridge looking back towards Wentworth Point. What's happened now, which is interesting to me, is this idea of Richard Sennett's idea of open cities as opposed to closed cities intrigues me, where we can't really anticipate outcomes like we think we can. The bridge, now that it's happening, is having an influence of change upon the whole development. So all of a sudden, our client's thinking of wants to put in substantial retail facilities, supermarkets, health facilities, gymnasiums, libraries, and we're doing transactions with the council to enable this to happen. So suddenly the ground plane will be alive and there'll be real social amenity in the development. It's a larger topic, but no planning process guarantees any of this to happen and no government regulations require it. So this is a fascinating study for me, 11 hectares with 3,000 apartments, to watch it organically grow. And forces like the bridge trigger things happening. So these are some of the client presentation we did a couple of weeks ago on learning from Japan about active edges, how to do activated streets, how to get second floor activities, how to embrace density into the edges of streets and step outside the normal Australian shopping centre typology, even though in investment terms it will be exactly that. Another topic in my area of agrodynamics is the issue of scale. I've done a bit of work on this. This is an interesting book, if you ever come across it, called American Vitruvius, which was reprinted 15 years ago, I suppose. But it's a reprint of a book done by Hegeman and Peets in the 1920s to try and stop modernism coming to America. They saw Art Deco as an extension of European classicism. And in it, there's this cartoon from 1904, which people would have thought was funny, which was going to show what would happen to cities if modernism was allowed to happen. Of course, it's not funny to us because it's exactly what all cities look like. And in this book, Herman Martens is cited as doing work on scale. And I could never really find the source books, but one day my librarian contacted me and said she found one in an antiquarian bookshop in Switzerland, so I bought it for $500, called Der Optische Maßstab, The Optics of Scale. And Martens, even in 1884, had to travel to Europe to try and piece together again the visual rules around which European spaces were designed. So, Plas van Dam, for example, he was really a surveyor. It's full of charts of the dimensions of great public places around Europe. And he reduced it to 3 simple rules that he thought were followed. Cones of vision based on 1:1 at 45 degrees, 2:1 and 3:1. And you can use them as guidelines, and he maintains they were used as guidelines to ameliorate scale. So this one, 27 degrees or 2:1, defines public space, which is really a normal cone of vision without having to raise your head, without scale being threatened. 18 degrees or 3:1, he maintained that beyond that, buildings are no longer space defining. That would explain the overly wide main street in some country towns that don't seem to be a place. And at 1:1, he says our eye interrogates details. So that wall to me becomes more interesting in its totality because it's in my 45 degree cone of vision. So he applied this with his diagrams to design of art galleries, to scale artwork to viewing points. And this diagram in particular we now use for designing our buildings in streets. We take all of our perspective views from footpaths where people actually are, and we judge the facades by what they're offering to people. So when you walk around Paris, you'll see these rules in play. They were well understood, bearing in mind that these streets were used down the middle. They didn't have parking down the edges at the time, and people walked through the middle. So from the middle, this cornice here would be 45 degrees, and from the other side of the street, 27 degrees. And you'll see around Paris this cornice all the time, two floors up, which captures the visual attention of the pedestrian, whilst the building itself might be larger than that. And you can see that line used comprehensively through the city. And you can also see when modern architecture is inserted how it fails to do any of this. And you can understand why now in central Paris any new buildings have to be done in limestone in the old style. So this kind of micro-environment of the pedestrian has more detail, the detail's richer. And you can see here in Japan exactly the same principles of optics, even though they're not using Martin's laws. Any sensible advertising agency will place signage in the place that's mostly viewed by people passing. So I think these are, if you like, innate rules of human psychology that are worth understanding if our cities are to communicate at all to pedestrians. And you can see here a sort of emergence of more stuff on the base of an otherwise polite modernist building. Over time, these accretions of human activity attach themselves to buildings, even though the architect may never have intended it to happen. Richard Sennett talks about closed cities and open cities. A closed city is that building in the background where the architects presume they know everything that's going to happen in the life of that building and that it will exist in time that way. An open city suggests that things emerge. So the stuff in the lower two levels is emerging in response to the community that actually uses the building. Japan also has lots of other examples of Martin's rule where streets are so narrow that the 45 degree rule really applies to the whole street experience because you can't get further back from a building than that. And these are the wonderful historic streets of Edo which really play to a single person. So every arrangement, every sign that's tilted down, every decorative element in the street is tuned to the optics of the passing pedestrian and of course makes that city rich. Typically in Tokyo, we'll see big walls of buildings around a neighbourhood where people live and valleys with villages in them. So the social experience of people is to really to go down into the village, to the human scale, to shop, and back into the apartments to live. I applied these rules of scale to a project we did recently in College Street, on the edge of Hyde Park. There's the old police centre. You can see the blue dot up there. This was an old office building from the 70s that... It was the first privately owned building after a row of public buildings that stretches 2 kilometres from the Sydney Opera House up towards it. So we had a duty of care to play to its context, which I think we did very well. That's the building on the left. We recycled it through great staging difficulty, came up with a design that played to its context in a number of ways. First of all, we split it into twin buildings so it would communicate with the spires of St Mary's Cathedral some distance away and help to create that big public open space. This is the Civic Meridian, as we call it. It's my partner Doug Michaels and one of our architects. I photographed in the office building when we noticed that it lines up with the Opera House sales. The light coming over the horizon is just my flash. There's nothing cosmic about it. And so there's this wonderful belonging of the building on that axis. And other things we did was to use Martin's rules. We discovered that the main central form of the museum building actually subscribed to Martin's rules, not the old Sydney Grammar building, which was lower. In the competition, we were the only ones to have a podium so high. It's 5 levels high. And so we tuned it into the existing street with a sandstone podium that communicates with the rest of the street. We divided the building into 6, which matched the 6 original terrace houses that were on the site, and we used the optics to force the materiality of the lower part of the building. Then we matched the depth of the building with the offsets in Sydney Grammar so that all those planes read to the pedestrian. And then we tilted the balconies slightly out. You can see the tower tilts slightly. We tilted so that it was on axis with the War Memorial, which is a subtle thing, but when you're at the War Memorial, quite nice because it's actually looking at you rather than just following the street plan. So that's using rules of optics to, if you like, bring some sort of science to how we place buildings in an existing context. So on to Tokyo. Why do I keep going to Tokyo? These are some of the reasons. Again, on the subject of shared ways, this is a shopping district called Gioka. Typical street where you can see people walk around casually. Then if I couple up these videos and you look at the street a few minutes later, on the right you will see another event, and I think it's worth observing how casually everybody takes this event. And I think these are some of the things we need to understand about human beings before we go off and spend billions on transport infrastructure that's dedicated just to transport. You can actually mix it up and nobody gets hurt. And so in these environments, I become an observer of people, I suppose. The stuff that's added beyond the architecture is really what makes these places. So architecture becomes a support mechanism, not the main game. And I think for any young architect, that's really worth understanding. Don't think the world needs you to define everything. Richard Sennett, who's the head of the Sociology Department of the London School of Economics, talks about this. Closed cities, where forms are over-defined and chop out people's behaviour. Every line you draw dictates social behaviour. So we should be careful about what we're drawing and how important we think the details are that we're creating. Because in the end, the buildings are a backdrop to what people will do, and people will adapt the place to suit their needs anyway. And so what's important in the street is really more important than the buildings is how people are dressed, what they're doing, how interesting they are, delivery systems, stuff that's going on in the street, the ability to walk around, fashion itself. Tokyo is a fashion exporter, so is Paris. Why is this? Because there's places to wear clothes. There's places to wear clothes where people look at the clothes. So when you're on a packed escalator in Tokyo, you're usually looking at beautiful fabrics or something interesting. It's not actually a burden to be in the crowd. It's actually a piece of theatre. And all of the economic activity that comes from that is basically the economics of people walking around. And so you can see babies. You know, everybody's out in the public domain. Babies, pets, all kinds of things going on in densities that we would find numerically shocking. And again, vehicles mixing in with it. So in Tokyo, we see cars as pets, not cars as transport. Cars are a stupid form of transport in Tokyo. It's like driving through the Royal Easter Show to get somewhere. You can do it, but it takes a really long time. They squeeze through pedestrian crowds at a snail's pace. And you have to be able to park your car on your own property in Tokyo, so people go to all sorts of lengths to be able to do that. You can't own a car unless you can accommodate it on your own property. And then there's aerodynamic cars. You can make cars do more. The one on the left I thought particularly charming. On Sundays they run a market stall under their car out of their garage. That's a fantastic use of real estate. Little cars insinuate themselves into the environment. Here's a little Fiat Bambino that is owned by the restaurant proprietor of an Italian restaurant. So he just turns his car into decor each day and parks it at the front door. It's part of his theming. And then there's all these tiny little vans and the Volkswagen coffee shop with garden that settles itself into the neighbourhood. And aerodynamic architecture, I think the great thing to learn from Tokyo, as opposed to this obsession with European cities, you know, as much as I love Jan Gehl, I really don't think there's that much to learn from Copenhagen or from the charm of Europe. I think we're blinded by the charm. European cities are beautiful because of the years they were built in, principally. 70% of Tokyo was destroyed by firebombing in World War II. So what's great about Tokyo is to go there and see that modern architecture can also create dynamic street environments. And for us who are in a culture creating new architecture, that's an important thing to get confidence from. And there's lots of examples of really great streets with really contemporary architecture, as opposed to the background charm of handcrafted Europe. And all of these little systems, you know, the way restaurants and planting and edges are interpreted is endlessly fascinating. The distribution of shops, tiny little high-quality supermarkets spread through neighbourhoods, all comes from pedestrian traffic. Detail at street level comes from the pedestrian traffic. and the people themselves and how interesting they are as actors in these situations. And then sometimes architecture itself is interesting enough to be agrodynamic in itself. Some buildings are beautifully detailed at a scale that they are works of art in themselves. If ever you go to Japan, something that took me years to appreciate, which is really important to observe, is this idea of a zone of public-private interdominion or collaboration between public and private domains. There's an old rule in urban design that we should always be clear about what's public and what's private. In Tokyo, it's very ambiguous. And it comes from a historic situation whereby all of this stuff you see on the edge of the street there is actually on private land. And up until the Edo period, there was a rule that said, if you build your building 500 millimetres from any boundary, you can build your building as high as you like. That's this far, without any objection. So neighbours negotiated with each other to build on the boundary. So if you let me build on the boundary, I'll let you build on the boundary. And that was a metre in each other's property if they could do it. And so you'll see most buildings in Japan are like that. You'll never see a party wall, you'll see two walls doing this. But when it came to the street frontage, that 500 millimetres was non-negotiable with the city. So it remains private land on the edge of the streets. And this is where all the action is in terms of the life of the city. These screens that you see in old Japanese buildings in curved bamboo or bamboo like this are dog screens to stop dogs soiling your land. It's a sort of maintenance procedure to protect your strip against dogs. And then you find that that strip of land is put to work with gardens, edges, things that people contribute to the public domain. Because there's so much fragility and beauty in the things that people do in front of their houses, the community respects it back. And sure enough, as you dig deeper and talk to people, you find there's these little markers here. That one says City of Kyoto, and that's a survey mark telling you where the edge of the city stops. And if you park your car on your own property, so that concrete to the left is actually private property, to the right is public. If you park your car, that guy's actually breaking the law, you can see he's slightly over his boundary. Probably would be booked in Japan. And so then merchandising, shops, they're allowed to do things on the edges of the property. On the right there is a shopping centre designed by Ando called Omotesando Hills. And you can see he's replicated the idea of the stormwater drain from old Japan as a sort of fake. So there's ceremonial purpose in stepping across this drain into the property. And that mediating zone, you can see here, people then put timber over the drains so they can use it. Car parking and loading is ambiguously partly on private and public land. So it's a zone of functional flexibility as well. But principally, it's a thing that adds life to movement around the city. You can see people on cyclists can pull up at shops and do transactions directly. And all kinds of claptrap and things happen in that zone to beautify the city. And so you have a whole community in collaboration daily on every street, the owners and the passerby, in a contract of trust and confidence about what each is doing in their role. The ubiquitous vending machines are also 500 millimetres deep and are on private land. So some people's retirement funds are really, and there's always little kitchen tidies next door, they're always neat as a pin, so you'll find that the owner of that property comes out and empties that during the day. So they maintain it because it's in their interest to keep the front of their property clean. You'll see people at dawn out picking cigarette butts up off the street. People clean the street in front of their own houses because they're stakeholders in it. And this old lady's put the whole of her frontage to work. You can see she's got advertising on her front door and vending machines as far as she can stretch them across the property. Probably her sole income. So that condition of edges is something I don't think, possibly unique to Japan. You see versions of it in old Chinese cities, but a very important one, one that we don't understand and have cut out of our subdivision of our cities. And then you get merchandise itself on the edges. So the soft edge of private property is a great thing to observe in Japan. And then, of course, it means that buildings engage you with tiny little things. So you find yourself walking up to a window, looking at stuff in there that's this big in this huge metropolis. So there's an intimacy about that that is denied to us for as long as we move around in cars. And for as long as there aren't places that are worth walking around, and for as long as all our shopping experience is corporatised and placed in shopping centres. So the retail experience, even the merchandise itself that we get in Australia, is extremely poor compared to Japan. The tools on offer in huge hardware stores here are the same price as, but half the quality of those you can get in Japanese stores. And I think it's simply because of the higher density of traffic you can deliver through shopping in highly serviced pedestrian environments. So these tiny little things become very specialised. Shops then start to sell individual pencils. This is a pigment shop near Ueno that had a little sign, not a paint shop, but a pigment shop for oil paints, that had a sign in the window saying that they sold pigments to Monet in the 1880s and still in the same premises. Or this tea shop in Ueno that's been in the same family for 300 years. And so tiny little things that taste as good as they look, boiled lotties with gold leaf on them, all these kinds of things happen, I think, from the interaction of a city with people. Transit is the big thing. And here I use the term influent. An influent has an ecological meaning, which is a non-dominant organism that has a major effect on the balance of a plant or animal community. And I think in this case of Tokyo, it's the transit systems that are the influent. We all know the cliche of the busy Shinjuku station, where the commuters come in. Probably wouldn't have occurred to you that most of these people are also cyclists, if not all of them. At the other end of their journey, they ride to the station by bike. Shinjuku has, I think, 1 million commuters in and out, in the morning and out in the afternoon. The population of Tokyo itself swells by 2 million people during each day. There are railways, 1,300 railway stations, more or less every 800 kilometres or a kilometre across the city. I won't dwell on these because of time. But whilst there are cars, the sort of prioritising of pedestrians and the volume of pedestrians is the most noticeable thing about Japan and Tokyo in particular. Again, for reasons of time, I'll speed this up, but I do wonderful studies of... On the right there, you'll see a lady coming out of a shop and see how proficiently her kids all cooperate with climbing on the bike. And in the left, you see her arriving. These bikes are called mama charis or mother chariots, especially designed battery assisted with a front fork with a shock absorber in it, so it's hard to tip the bike over. And typically in neighbourhoods, you'll see a mother, two kids and the shopping riding the bike. So the World Health Organization predicts that 30% of Australians will be obese by 2015. In Japan, it's 3% of men and 1% of women. And I think it's largely because daily life requires people to walk around and ride bikes. And so in my early trips, I was fascinated to know how their metro rail system interacted with pedestrians. What systems did they have to get up and over and in and around and under it? They have this wonderful thing. It's called a level crossing. And trains just run at surface level. So you have to stop and think, why do we allow roads to cut through our cities at surface level, but we're so against public transport doing it when there's actually safety controls? Why do we think we have to spend 10 times the money burying them underground rather than run them on the surface or elevate them? So in Tokyo, everyone understands this. This is Shimokitazawa. This crossing doesn't exist anymore, by the way, but every 2 minutes or more sometimes trains go through, and then Easter show type crowds cross over and the gate goes ding, 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 and all happens seamlessly, part of life in Tokyo. This is a prestigious shopping precinct called Jioka, and to the Australian eye, this would be like Double Bay sort of shops with lots of people here on the weekends, and what you see happening next, of course, is shocking to us, but happens every few minutes in Tokyo. So I think in urban planning, it's the adaptability of people that we grossly underestimate. And then in those environments, because they're so busy, we see little seven-year-old kids heading across Tokyo by themselves to go to school. That doesn't happen in Sydney. Sydney's dangerous from the point of view of traffic and strangers for kids to go to school. So we shouldn't be so confident about how great Australian cities are and how awful density might be. So I found these maps, 1 to 10,000 maps, you know, like bushwalking maps, and bought all of them for Tokyo. And they show every building in Tokyo, railway lines and what have you. But more interestingly, they show shops in dark red. So I've been able to go and visit neighbourhoods based on these little organic diagrams. So these are some of the ones. You can see there, there's an underground railway running under the Marunouchi line, runs under the lower suburbs. These are more or less 800 metres apart. And you can see how the shopping activity, like electrical short circuits between the railway stations, creates all of the movement patterns. So at Asagaya on the left, we can see a typical Shotengai, which is a covered street covered by the municipality, not by a property developer. So all the properties are individually owned, but the street is covered. This one's a kilometre long and full of all sorts of interesting things. Here's another one with where two-thirds of the roof opens. And here's another giant one in Sendai. I particularly like the Buddha-Santa combo. Kyoto has a huge installation of them. So around these stations too, of course, each of those red dots, this is a bicycle parking warning sign telling you not to park your bike except in the locations shown. There's so many bikes, they're a nuisance. There's typically a little bus and taxi plaza at the station, and then as you wander off from the station, all the best stuff, the fresh food, the food shops and things all happen cycle-ready and pedestrian-ready immediately adjacent to the station. And then as you go off, this is Koenji, down the little streets towards the other station. Again, using the little 500mm setback zone, the streets are alive with all sorts of offerings and fragile, delicate things that make living in the city so pleasurable, and all the interesting characters who live in the neighbourhood. So you'll find little things like business cards on tables and clothing, flowers promoting the shop upstairs. I think you'll find this is quite contrary to the sort of net belief of what dense cities might be. So I call this type of cycling ultra-local cycling, which is the best definition you'll find in cycling is utility cycling, which I don't think fully describes it. Not recreational cycling, not commuter cycling. They're the only types we see. And the war between motorists and cyclists in Sydney at the moment anyway is one between the commuter cyclist and the commuter motorist. The commuter cyclist just wants their own lane. They're not going to contribute anything to the economy along that thoroughfare. Now, whilst I understand it and I agree with pushing cars back, it's not what this is. This is cycling as an enhanced form of walking, where bikes are welcome anywhere. And you can see how fundamental it is to living in Tokyo. So see the widths of these footpaths. You can ride on anywhere in Tokyo, footpaths, roads, wherever you like, and everybody understands that. So cyclists take care of pedestrians, and all sorts of other movement happens in and amongst them, and little kids and people don't seem to get damaged. So all the kit that goes with it, and there's whole shops full of cycle fashion, clothing just for this, and you see this frequently, you know, mum with two kids on the bike. And this is a statue I saw in Takayama, which is a statue of Kintaro. Kintaro is a myth around which Boys' Day was conjured. And it combined the carp, you know, those big carp kites that they have. And the legend is one of independence for little boys. And the carp, because it swims upstream, represents the kind of tenacity little boys should have. So it seemed to me that this is the life that mothers afford to their little kids through cycles. Kids get the front row seat from birth. They get to ride around the neighbourhood with mum, with the wind in their hair, from being very young. This is an amazing introduction to a city. So by the time they're going to school, they've spent 5 years meeting the greengrocer, knowing the people in the street. They're already a citizen at five, so it's not that surprising when you think about that, that they can walk to school on their own. But it's like a big continuous ride when you think about it. Being out with mum is good fun. We stick our kids in the back seat with a PlayStation and ignore them. Or we stick them in the back seat of the stroller. When we go to the park, not all of us, some of them just sit in a car and let a bit of sun in on their white shoes and that's an outing. Or here's a little motorcyclist in training with a Summon Hats t-shirt. Pretty cool. And here, see how young that kid is, no helmets. And then they graduate up so that kids ultimately get their own bike. And here's a scene, I just took a few photographs. She's obviously arrived at the intersection, her parents are coming behind her, and without looking at them, she's under strict instructions not to go onto the next road until they're there. And as soon as they arrive without looking at her, she sort of gets going again. then pretty soon she's on her own bike and she becomes a cycling citizen. This is a mother looking in on a kindergarten. So, you know, that could be a street in Balmain. I really don't know why we don't just ride on the footpaths. Here they are as a nuisance, clogging up the footpaths. People can ride with one hand, even when they're elderly. And then they graduate to tricycles and ultimately to things for carrying groceries around so that ageing in place becomes possible. Things that act as seats when they need to rest. You see very old ladies still living at home. You see cycle parking. These are parks, bikes that are parked where they shouldn't be. There's lots of structured bike parks. This is a piece of architecture for bicycle parking. A couple of hundred metres from a station, you see there's a motorised belt to take the bike up so you don't have to push it. Different charges for parking, and then massive parks. This would cost 100 yen per hour in a shopping centre, which is $1 an hour to park your bike. And in the big commuter stations 3 kilometres away, there's 5 of these, several acres each, where it costs $1 a day to park your bike. So this is where those people at Shinjuku Station started their journey on bikes. And because of the pricing of the bike parking, they go more than the standard Todd 400 metres. They'll go to the cheap bike park, which is more or less 3 kilometre ride each way in the mornings. That's 7 o'clock in the morning, as the chockers. And there's new businesses opening all the time offering parking. And then you notice here, underground. You know, it looks like a street, but actually it's a bike park. They're everywhere. I felt lucky to stumble across one once, but now I realise they're all over the place. So cycling is a very important add-on to the metro rail systems. Should I stop?
We have another 5 minutes.
Good. 5 minutes in Beijing. The reason I'd show you Beijing is that I think there's some remarkable similarities here. After we did a lot of work on the Olympics, I went a few times to Beijing to talk about the Olympics when they were forming the Beijing Olympics in 2001. And I stumbled across this market at the workers' gymnasium, which closed 6 weeks later so they could do renovations to the building. And it was a spontaneous daily market based entirely on bicycles. And I think this is the kind of open city thinking that's fantastic and is sadly gone now. But look at the skill in the merchandising at this place. Look how fantastic it is that everything's open. This is how I imagine Greek agoras used to be. How everything's brought in bulk by these people on a daily basis from dawn until 1 o'clock in the afternoon and then it goes home. This would be the truck equivalent of the bicycle. Everything's delivered from the farms to these markets on these super cycles. And if you look at that thing probably carries a ton, I think, if you look at its suspension systems. So the owner came out when I was photographing this and asked me what I was doing and posed, very proud of his vehicle. So he'd be a trucking contractor in Beijing. This is one of my favourites, the Eggman, and a good case of taking photographs and thinking about them later. Think of the responsibility of delivering those. And then when you look closely at him, he's got his right hand permanently on a brake in case, and his tyres are slightly flat just to give him a little bit more cushioning. Urban designer, you see. The Eggman. And this is the coal burner man. They were all going out of fashion when I took this and replaced by gas. But you get these made up of coal dust burners. And the guys riding them are like in slow motion and everybody stands aside lest he should have to start again because of the inertia of getting moving. So back to the market, you can see the whole delivery system is done on the bikes. And then the whole merchandising system is done off the back of bikes. You see there all the front wheels facing each other and the trays on the back are used for selling off. This is amazingly sustainable, innovative kind of self-reliance that people organise. Everything's fresh, everything exposed. So our delivery systems distance us from the reality of this, I fear. And there's great skill in the way everything's merchandised and sold, the way they pass things to you, the way the boxes are used and tilted to the optics of retail. And then here's a lounge chair someone's got for their mum. She obviously doesn't go to the market, but she goes out every morning and sits in the car park until her... And then people socialise too. This is the agrodynamic processional benefit of a market, is the meeting place. And so people gather around and do it. that lady's looking at me, and I was a bit embarrassed. I just photographed it because she had a trolley, but it was only later I realised it's actually a like a little toy stroller with a cardboard box in it. It's someone who's extremely poor can actually invent something to go to the markets. Then these are other markets on construction sites that happen on an impromptu basis. And look at the collaboration between all of their boxes to set it up almost like a department store. Then at 12:30 or so, everything's packed up, put on the bike, taken back into the streets and back to the farm. So the hutong, James Werrick tells me that these hardly exist anymore. I spent a couple of days walking around. This one was done early in the morning. And it has striking similarities to the streets of Tokyo, I think. Kids going to school, this sort of social interaction, retailing beside the street, people stopping up, pulling up and buying. These are all breakfast options, if you like, done in extremely simple ways. And look at all the, although it's very funky and poor, the sort of architectural innovation that goes on to adapt these buildings to the street. And they're amazingly picturesque and inventive in the way people solve their own problems with no money. So I was having a great time this morning walking along, amazed by it all and fussed by people. I'd walked through there at midnight the night before. You never feel threatened at all and realise that this was how Beijing functioned. The only bits of this that are left are really like the rocks now. You go on tours through them as artefacts. And then you get to a point in the street where this happens. Literally, it stops and it's gone. And what was a laneway. And I went back to an area like this 8 weeks after I'd been there and completely gone. So that kind of mimicking of the West, to me, is a great shame that they're racing as fast as they can towards the 1970s because they think it's cool. And building housing estates that are closed systems. And I think really what will happen in China is they'll put high-tech villages back, just like Japan has. And I think that'll be the great thing to see. But to date, that doesn't seem to be happening. And so, enterprising as they are, the tea girls are still wandering amongst the ruins selling things. They're indomitable. And I wondered what these people were doing in the ruins. And it turns out they're actually retrieving things and making little stalls by the edge of the street to sell them. It's an amazing capacity and resilience in people that I think should give us confidence in ourselves, that we don't have to be so sophisticated in our thinking or so definitive. And here's a bicycle that turned into a permanent food shop and was abandoned. So that's a bicycle that became a building, I guess, because a guy traded there consistently every day. And the last image for today is the ultimate business, you know. It's got street frontage and parking for both a proprietor and a customer. Thank you.